Test. All right. Let's just open with a word of prayer and get right into the word. Heavenly Father, I just thank you that I can be here this morning and that my brothers and sisters in Christ can be here this morning. I pray for those who can't be here this morning. And Lord, let us remember that in your word, we all need to listen. We all need to apply it to our lives, Lord. So open our eyes, open our hearts. Maybe we'll leave here today a little different. We ask this in Jesus' name, amen. So last week, we spoke about what pride is. It's a self-exaltation, you know, that kind of thing. The I, me, and mine thinking, and it can dominate our lives. In fact, it dominates the lives of most people. It's in total opposition to God. It's the anti-God way of thinking. And it's against God's plan and purpose for my life and for your life. And we spoke about the total devastation pride can cause to the individual and to families and to churches and to nations. Pride divides, it pulls apart, and then it destroys. How many have said something or done something to someone and you feel a pulling apart? You feel an actual force that is trying to separate you, and that's what pride does. The other bad news is everyone is infected with pride. And so this morning I thought that we could begin by listing some of the common symptoms of pride. In other words, are you proud? Let's look at it. So in 1993, a comedian called Jeff Foxworthy released an album. You might remember it. It was called You Might Be a Redneck If. Okay. It sold over 3 million copies, and it helped millions of people discover if they were a redneck. And when you played the album, it sounded something like this. You might be a redneck if your belt buckle doubles as a serving platter. You might be a redneck if the fifth grade is referred to as your senior year. You might be a redneck if there's a stuffed possum anywhere in your house. You might be a redneck if you buy your wife tube socks at the flea market. I didn't know anyone noticed I did that. But you might be a redneck if you keep a can of Raid on the kitchen table. And you might be a redneck if your school fight song was Dueling Banjos. Okay, so that's kind of fun, but let's switch from fun to serious. And so we're going to rewind and we're going to do this again, only this time we're going to change the object. Instead of saying, you might be a redneck if, we're going to use, you might be struggling with pride if. And so let's take a look at this list. You might be struggling with pride if you have a tendency to take everything personally. You might be struggling with pride if you're easily offended. You might be struggling with pride if racism, prejudice, and class envy are embedded in your thinking. You might be struggling with pride if you're never satisfied, never contented with much of anything. You might be struggling with pride if you seldom ask for help, even if you need it. You might be struggling with pride if certain tasks are beneath your position. You might be struggling with pride if you constantly feel you have to teach people things. You might be struggling with pride if most of your conversation is about you. You might be struggling with pride if you quickly discard the advice of others. You might be struggling with pride if you have a constant need for attention and for the approval of others. You might be struggling with pride if you have a difficult time submitting to authority. You might be struggling with pride if you justify your sin instead of admitting it. You might be struggling with pride if you think you're humble. You might be struggling with pride if you want to be the center of attention. You might be struggling with pride if you're vain about your appearance. You might be struggling with pride if you're not teachable. You might be struggling with pride if you don't like to be surpassed by anyone. You're a sore loser. You might be struggling with pride if your life is constantly in conflict. And you might be struggling with pride if you've lost your fear of God. Now, this list I compiled from several different lists from pastors and teachers on their interpretation of what the Bible teaches on pride. It's a list that just touches the tip of the iceberg. Pride is a very complex, it's a multifaceted topic. And in the last two messages last week and the message I'm going to bring this week, I'm just skimming the surface of what pride is. And I would encourage you, do your own in-depth study. Get in the Word. Find out where pride is in your own life. It's so utterly important. Most people, when asked, what is the opposite of love? And of course, the most common answer is hate. And they'd be correct. The opposite of love, I love you, I hate you, I love you. But over the years, and especially in the last couple weeks, I believe there's a better choice. And I think the opposite of love might just be pride. And so in support of that, I'm going to share a brief glimpse into the lives of two people. Their character and their attitudes are opposite. They're at opposite ends of the spectrum of life. One person's name is Mr. Love, and the other person is named Mr. Pride. So first we're gonna take a quick look into the life of Mr. Love. Mr. Love is patient and kind. Mr. Love is never jealous, he's never boastful, and he's never rude. Mr. Love does not demand his own way. And Mr. Love, by nature, isn't irritable. Mr. Love keeps no records of being wronged. He's very quick to forgive and to forget. Mr. Love is deeply saddened and cares greatly about people being mistreated or treated unjustly. Mr. Love rejoices when the truth is victorious over lies and falsehoods. Mr. Love is determined to never give up. Mr. Love knows victory is available over every circumstance in his life. And Mr. Love lives life in a secure and never-changing envelope of hope. Mr. Love. So now let's contrast Mr. Love with the life of Mr. Pride. Mr. Pride lacks patience, and because he lacks patience, he's often very unkind. Mr. Pride is jealous and envious of just about everything and everyone. Mr. Pride is easily irritated when things don't go his way. Mr. Pride never forgets, and he will never forgive someone who has wronged him. Revenge gives Mr. Pride a good feeling. You got what you deserved. Mr. Pride hides behind a facade of lies and deceptions to protect his image. Mr. Pride gives up easily. Mr. Pride gets discouraged easily and is prone to walk away from the challenges of life. And so at this point, the obvious question I could ask you is your life more akin to that of Mr. Love or Mr. Pride? But I'm not going to ask you that question, since I already did, really. Because here's what I know. That my life and your life is a composite of the lives of Mr. Love and Mr. Pride. Christians are the only people on earth. You want to feel special? We're the only people on earth with two natures, distinct from each other. The pride or sin nature is the one we and everyone else in the world was born with. And the love or God-oriented nature is the one we received when we were reborn into the family of God. And the questions we should be asking ourselves daily, which nature, pride or love, dominates my life? Which nature? Like it or not, we're all destined to live out our earthly lives in this continuous state of siege. There's an old Indian proverb or something. You've probably heard it. It just now came to my mind. It was about two dogs fighting. One's good, one's bad. And the little Indian boy asked, well, which one's going to win? And the wise older Indian said, whichever one you feed, that's the one that's going to win. What nature in your life is going to win? Whichever one you feed, that's the nature that's going to win. And pride and love are natures within us that are in a continual battle. Did you know your life is a battleground? You know? Did you know that the disciples of Jesus struggled with pride? Yeah, they did. You can read about it, and it was pretty obvious. They went around kind of arguing, who's the greatest? You know, is it Matthew? John? James? Who's the greatest? And why do you think I should be the greatest? Pride. The Apostle Peter struggled with kind of a unique pride. He didn't want to associate with them Gentiles. You know, I am a Jew. Not that I'm proud of it, but I'm not going to have anything to do with you Gentiles, you see. That irritated the Apostle Paul so much that he had to rebuke Peter in public. Wow, how would you like to be rebuked in public by the Apostle Paul? But then again, the Apostle Paul struggled with his own pride, didn't he? And so we're going to take a moment and look at his story because it's very interesting. Paul's pride, in fact, was so dangerous to his calling that God intervened directly to nip it in the bud. Let me stop here. Don't underestimate the damage that pride has done, is doing, and will do in the future if you don't recognize it in your own life. It will destroy not only your relationships here, but the relationship you desire to have with God. With God. So you can read the entire story of this struggle that Paul had in 2 Corinthians chapters 11 and 12, but I want to point out where it came from. So 14 years before he even wrote the book of 2 Corinthians, it seems God invited him to his house. Wow. And Paul was transported, the Bible says, to paradise. Have you ever been invited someplace that made you feel special? Just think what it'd be like to get an invite from God and be whisked up to paradise. Imagine that made Paul feel pretty special. I was thinking about this, and just to let you know my politics a little bit, which I shouldn't do because this is a church, but I was thinking, what would it be like to be invited to the White House? And then I thought, I don't want to go. And so during the following years, I probably shouldn't have said that, I'm sorry. And during the following years following the visit, Paul was given revelations directly from God. God gave him things and told him things that he was telling nobody else. And as he wandered the land proclaiming what he had gotten from God, proclaiming the gospel, planting churches, and recording everything that he had been given in doctrine and teachings from God. And by the way, that's much of our Bible today, the New Testament. And was that something to be proud of? Going to heaven, God talking to me with things he's not telling anybody else. Walking around, planting churches, watching the Church of Christ just explode. And also during this time, if you read his story, he said, I endured a lot of hardships. I was beaten with rods and stone, shipwrecked, floating around in the ocean for a day and a half. A lot of prison time. I really suffered for the Lord. You know, that can be a gateway to pride if you're not careful. Go to the VFW some afternoon and listen to the war stories. You know, and they're proud of their suffering. We're not to be proud of our suffering. So God, who knows us infinitely better than we know ourselves, you know, why should you have this really good communion with God? Because he knows you better than you know yourself. How many here have asked him, why did I do that? You know? Well, God knows why you did it. Talk to him about it. Maybe he'll tell you. Or maybe he doesn't even want you to know. You couldn't take it. He knows ourselves. He knows us better than we know ourselves. And Paul, he knew, was getting a little, and Paul used this word, conceited. Paul was getting conceited. And you saw the reasons that he might be. And you know, I remember being in school. And I could spot them conceited people right away, you know. They were the captain of the football team. They were the, you know, valedictorian. They were the one that everyone wanted to eat lunch with, them conceited people, you know. They'll get theirs. Oh, wait, that's Mr. Pride. That's Mr. Pride. So Paul's ego and self-image were becoming overinflated. And God knew that Paul's overinflated self-image, if not kept in check, would be a great hindrance to God's plan for Paul's life. God's plan and purpose for Paul's life would be disrupted if we didn't get a handle on this pride. And so God allowed Paul to be afflicted with what the Bible says is a thorn in the flesh. There's been a lot of discussion about what's the thorn in the flesh. It can be anything, scholars say, from a person like Alexander the coppersmith, or it can be something physical. Some people think he had problems with his eyes that was very painful and unpleasant. But whatever the thorn was, it must have not felt good, because Paul prayed 3 times just about that thorn. And his prayer was, God, take this away, please. God, this is the 2nd time I've asked you. Pretty please, take this away. God, are you listening? Take this away. I don't know if I can deal with it. And God answered. Not the answer you want to hear. You know, have you ever talked to God and you expect him to answer you the way you want to hear? I do that all the time. I talk to God and say, you know, Lord, and so I'm talking to you, and now I already have in my mind what I want your answer to be and what it should be, because I know more than you do, you see. But anyways, so Paul 3 times, and God says, hey, Paul, don't worry about it. My grace is sufficient. And, you know, Paul understood that. Not many of us might. You know, if we're struggling and whatnot, and Paul and God just says, my grace is sufficient. But think of that answer. Whatever you're going through right now, that's a good answer from God. Because what's found in that answer? My grace is sufficient. Everything. You're going to get through this. I'm going to get you through this. My grace toward you is sufficient to get you through any problem. Wow. Would we feel better if we really believe that? So I have a couple observations from the story. The first, we have trouble recognizing pride, much less controlling it. If you don't see pride, you're not going to ask God about it, and maybe you'll get a thorn and he'll remind you there's something wrong in your life. Number two, if God was willing, and understand this, you heard me repeat what Paul suffered. You know he had the responsibility and care for the churches. You know he was a heavily burdened person. Paul bore an extremely heavy burden. And yet God thought the pride in his life was so important to deal with, he added to that burden by allowing Paul to be afflicted with a thorn. So if that doesn't give you a little indicator about what God thinks of pride when he says, I hate it and I won't tolerate it, think about that. His servant Paul, I'm sorry, Paul, I got to afflict you with a little more because you're becoming conceited. Number three, because of number two, I can say pride may be the greatest hindrance to a fruit-bearing life. Is your life really bearing fruit? We talk about it, you know. We're to bear fruit. Some tenfold, from some 30, some 100. We're to bear fruit. Is your life bearing fruit? Might it be pride? Might it be the weed of pride that's growing around your tree and there's not going to be any fruit? And just for an insight, just mark this in your head, Romans chapter 7. Paul describes his own struggle with pride. It's a great chapter. And in it he calls himself wretched. I can't seem to get control of this pride. He recognized it. He said, "Wretched man that I am." But then he gave us the answer. He said, "But thanks be to God for Jesus Christ." You want the answer to pride? It's found in Christ. His strength, his compassion, his mercy, his wisdom. It's all found in Christ. Where are you focused? Are you focused on Christ? Guess what? You won't be focused on self. And right there, pride is starting to go away when you take your focus off self and focus on Christ, isn't it? The answer to pride is found in Jesus Christ. Alone. Don't get a self-help book unless it's this one. And this isn't a self-help book. This is a God-help book. Finally, this morning, someone asked me, and so I had to add it, they asked me to touch on good pride. This is the second time since I've been at Heritage I've been confronted with good pride. The first time was a 16-year-old, what I consider a know-it-all. Did you hear that? Well, anyway. And so we had a little debate about it. But the question of good pride's ticklish for me because I look at it a little differently than a lot of people look at it. And for me right now, if you ask me, what's good pride, I'll say, there's no such thing as good pride. And I'll say, there's no such thing as good sin, is there? And we all know what pride is. Pride is self-exaltation. How can that ever be good? And so you say, yeah, but Jim, let me ask you something. So when them athletes stand on that podium and the gold medal is placed around their neck or that blue ribbon for raising the biggest pig in 4-H is pinned on your shirt, is it okay to be proud of that? Huh? Sure, right? I heard that. However, before you answer sure, I'd like you to consider a question that God asks to all of us through his word. And by the way, this is God speaking to us, is it not? And so when you see a question asked in here, you could say, well, that's God asking that question. And it was asked in 1 Corinthians 4:7, and this is the question that God asks you. What do you have you weren't given? And if you received it, how can you boast as though you didn't? Let me repeat that. What do you have you weren't given, and if you received it, how can you boast, right, as though you didn't? So let me try to bring this down to my level and substitute a definition for good pride, okay? So let's break it up. It's two words. It's not just pride, it's good pride. So let's take the word good. What's good? What's good to God? Well, there's a big list of things that I put: thankfulness, gratitude, humility, true praise and worship, a recognition of who we are and who God is. Those kind of things are good to God. And so then if we put pride after that, what are we saying? We're saying pride is the action of praising God for those things that are good. That's what people call good pride, but it's not. It's acknowledging God for all he has given. So if I ask you again, I got this gold medal, you know, it's placed around my neck. I'm a champion. I worked hard for it. I sacrificed for it. Can't I be proud that I have it? And in lieu of God's question, God gave me all I required for this medal, didn't he? Everything I needed to get this medal came from where? God. First, he gave me life, right? He gave me life, and he knitted into my person all the natural abilities I possess. You know that passage where it said, God knitted me together? How many here knit? I don't want to see a man raise their hand, or I'll call you a girly boy. Okay, so I hear, though, that some men do knit. But when you knit, do you have something in mind? Like a sock or a scarf, sweater? And so the Bible says God knit us together individually. What does that mean? When he knitted Vi together, he knitted in a good voice, you know? And I don't know what other good things, but probably an awful lot. And he knitted you together and me together. And we're all different. God didn't make just 8 billion pairs of socks. We're all different. He made 8 billion different things. We're knitted together. And so he knitted me together and all the abilities I possess. If I can run 300 miles an hour, he gave it to me. And then he provided everything I needed for my training and achievement. He provided that. And finally, he orchestrated my opportunities. He directed my life, right? So in lieu of all of that, can I be proud of anything except God's purpose and plan for my life and his love and concern for me? That's what I'm going to be proud of. And so I'm going to close now with a video. And let me give you a little background. It's about 4 minutes. Sorry, I'm a little late. Dabo Swinney, and anyone named Dabo Swinney has to be a football coach. Right, you're right, he was a football coach. And he was coach of the Clemson Tigers in 2019. And in fact, during that season, he did an incredible feat. That team did an incredible feat. They went undefeated for 15 games and then won the national championship. But let me tell you, I watched during that season. And Dabo Swinney has a lot to be proud of. You're going to see it in his video, in his final interview after winning the national championship. But as he was going through the season, especially ESPN would go to interview him, and he would start to talk about the Lord, and they would cut it off, you see? First win, second win. Well, Dabo, we have to go. Well, Dabo, or they'd ask him another question and make him change the subject. And finally, the seventh win. Well, Dabo, you know, thank you, and you know. But after the national championship, with the whole nation watching, right, they couldn't do that. They were trapped, and they had to listen to what Dabo Swinney had to say. So I'd like you to listen to it too. It's 4 minutes.
Few coaches in any sport who show more joy than you do. How do you describe the joy of the moment?
Well, that's been my world here. And
for me personally, joy comes from focusing on Jesus, others, and yourself. Man, I mean, you know, very few people, there's so many great coaches that are so deserving of a moment like this that never get the chance to experience it. And to get to do it once and now to get to do it again, you know, it's a blessing. And it's just simply the grace of the good Lord to allow us to experience something like this. And I'm so happy for our team, our fans, our administration, our former players that love the ball. There ain't never been a 15-0 team, and I know we're not supposed to be here. We're just little old Clemson, and I'm not supposed to be here, but we are, and I am. And how about them Tigers, man? I'm so proud of our guys, these seniors. We beat Notre Dame in Alabama. We left no doubt. And we walk off this field tonight as the first 15-0 team in college football history. And all the credit, all the glory goes to the good Lord, number one. And number two, to these young people. When you get a young group of people that believe, are passionate, they love each other, they sacrifice, they're committed to a singleness of purpose, you better look out. Great things can happen, and that's what you saw tonight.
After four games, you made a decision. You chose Trevor Lawrence to become your quarterback. What did you see then that came true tonight?
How do you express good pride? Good example, isn't it? Takes a little boldness. You don't think that took a little boldness for Dabo Swinney to say that? Wow, that is really something. So as we close, think about the pride in your life. Said last week, I'll say it again this week. You can leave it right here. Give it to God. Admit it. That's the first thing. You know, so as we play our last song, go ahead. Let's just think about where we are in our lives. Let's stand.
This is my desire. Every moment I'm awake, Lord.